Hello, my name is Thomas Slavik, and this is the first lecture in the course Optimization and Data Science. The topic of the first lecture is an introduction. And first of all, I want to speak about the relation of these two topics, so optimization and data science, and this means the relation between data and optimization. Then, in this lecture, I will give examples for optimization problems. I will give the general formulation, the mathematical formulation of optimization problems, and the classification of different type of optimization problems. So I will start with the relation between data and optimization, and I will start with the notion or with the term optimization. And I will always use four questions to describe such kind of new topic. And the first question, what is it? How can it be summarized? So what is optimization? Optimization can be described as a process or a method to minimize or maximize a given quantity. So optimization in the mathematical sense means that there is a quantity which can be computed, and we want to minimize or maximize it. And this means that this quantity can be expressed as a mathematical function, and that we have some parameters or variables that we can tune, that we can change. Otherwise, we cannot optimize. So we have a system, we have a mathematical description of this system, we have a mathematical function that gives a quantity as a result or as output, and as input of this function we have some parameters, and we want to tune these parameters such that the output of the function is minimized or maximized. Why do we study optimization problems? There is a variety of practical applications in a variety of disciplines, so in physics, chemistry, biology, of course in economics, in all kinds of scientific or technical disciplines, there are problems which can be described as optimization problems. And of course, we human beings, we are always looking for, not for just one solution, we are always looking for an optimal solution. So basically, human beings are beings that tend to optimize solutions. And this is the reason and the importance of the topic of optimization in general. How does this work? So how does an optimization algorithm or an optimization method works? The optimization problems are usually formulated using mathematical terms, mathematical functions. This is our aim. Of course, it's also possible to describe an optimization problem very generally and not using mathematical terms, but in this lecture we are aiming for algorithms, for methods, and we are also aiming for analyzing optimization problems. So we rely on a mathematical formulation. Then what's typically is done is that criteria for existence and uniqueness of optima are derived or are stated, and there mathematical techniques are used. You will know this, or you might know this methods from school, where you compute the first order derivative to characterize a local minima or maxima. Solution algorithms, we are interested in not only in stating theoretical results, we are interested in solving optimization problems, and this is also an important topic of this lecture. And solution algorithms for optimization problems usually are iterative algorithms which can only approximate a solution. It's very rare that we can compute the exact minimum or maximum of a function. As a result, the speed of convergence and also the accuracy of these algorithms are important and are topics that we will study. So at the end, if we know, if we have learned about optimization, what can we do? Yeah, we can use these methods for all kinds of engineering and scientific problems. We have to formulate an optimization problem. We have to learn how to formulate it in a mathematical notation, but then we can apply these methods and algorithms. So we can state, we can tell something about existence and maybe in uniqueness of solutions, and we may compute a solution at least in an approximate way. We have then useful tools for other methods, or we have optimization methods sometimes are also only a part or an element of other methods. For example, training of neural networks, which is an example that I will come back later on. Inside, there is an optimization. So if we are talking about neural networks, optimization is an element of the, if I call it such in such a way, the method of artificial intelligence or neural working with neural networks. Optimization is a part of it. And what we can also do is we can do research. We can improve these methods, or we can adapt these methods for special problems. So we can do applications, but of course we can also proceed to advance these methods, to do research. So this is optimization. The second part is data or data science. Data science is a wide area of research because data is everywhere. And it's a hot topic nowadays, data science, and it's not always quite clear what is meant by this. So one point, of course, is the retrieval of data, the representation of data, just the storing of data, the processing of data, data mining, and retrieving information or knowledge out of the data. So as I said, this is a wide range. It's a broad topic. And the limits of this science, this data science, is not, or the limits are not completely clear or well defined. So you might find people which call some things data science, which maybe you won't call data science, or I won't call data science, and the other way around. So many topics, big data, data management, data analysis, data mining, also data assimilation, which are part of data science. Yeah, why do we study these kind of problems? I think this, I don't have to explain this, because we have a lot of data and we have the computers to exploit the data. And on the other hand, computer applications, maybe computer simulations, they also generate huge amount of new data. How does data science work? As I said, it's a broad area and there's a broad range of technologies. So the measurement, the transfer of data, the storage, the representation, compression, reduction, clustering, getting the useful information out of the data, comparing data, and one part is optimization methods which use data. And if we learned all this, we will not learn all of this in this lecture. Yeah, we will at least really know what is meant when people talk about data science. And we will know where and how the different methods can be applied. What is the right method to treat a problem in data science? And we can also transfer methods from other areas to data science, because optimization is a research area on its own. And we can use methods from optimization and put them into data science. Again, the example neural networks, there are many optimization algorithms that can be used in the training process of neural networks, and we can apply them. And of course, people are already doing this. So the topic of the lecture is optimization and data science. And I want to talk about on this slide what the end means, because we don't cover the whole range of optimization and we don't cover the whole range of data science. We cover optimization methods that are used in any application where optimization is an issue, because optimization, as I said, is a discipline, important discipline on its own. And of course, there are just optimization problems where the term data science might not appear. But in many cases, data is used in optimization. So the model is adapted to data. Data is used to tune the model such that a model, a simulation model, gives the right results, so that the results of the model come close to the data. This is a typical optimization problem, for example, used in weather forecast, in climate models, where I personally work on. We are working in my group, we are working on optimization for climate models. And we use data science topics as examples for optimization problems. So we will always concentrate on optimization problems where there's some data inside. Moreover, we cover the parts of data science which are related to optimization. This means data science methods are used to formulate or simplify an optimization problem, because in many cases you have so much data that you want to extract relevant information by some detection method of the important features of the data. We will cover this part. And maybe afterwards comes an optimization. The other topic is that the data science problem is in fact an optimization problem. As I said, we have measurement data for climate and we want to adapt the climate model to make a good prediction of the future climate. Then we use the data in the optimization. We use the data as input. Or data science methods use or need optimization methods. And again, this is training of neural networks is one example. In the course, we will discuss the relation between data and optimizations. We will study methods for data analysis, which include statistics, because of course, a statistic analysis is one way to deal with data, because data in real world are uncertain, they have errors, measurement errors. So we also study statistics. We study methods for reduction of data complexity, which can also be used to discover main features in data. Then of course we will have the formulation of classification of optimization problems. This is a point where I will start at the end of this first lecture already. And then we will study unconstrained optimization problems. You will understand later on what unconstrained and constrained means. And for optimization problems, we always have existence and uniqueness results, so theoretical results. Then we will state optimization problems. We have algorithms, and we also study algorithms applied in machine learning and neural networks. And then optimization problems with additional constraints with the same subtopics here. So in optimization, in the mathematical discipline of optimization, there's always a big classification is unconstrained and constrained. We will come to this later on. A very simple example for an optimization problem using data is data fitting or regression. We can also say we are building a reduced order model. We have some data points here, these red points. I write them like this. We have TK and ZK. So we have at certain time instance, we have measured data, and these are these pairs. And we want to have, we can see that it sounds, or it looks like it, that doesn't sound, it looks like a linear dependency, maybe with some errors. And the task might be to detect the parameters of this dependency. You will know that a linear dependency can be described by this affine linear function with two parameters A and B, and maybe we want to estimate an A and B, which is called a regression line. And this is the blue line here. So we want at least approximately that the output of this model function here, or this reduced order model, fits the data. And of course, you know that if you have 2 points, then you can have a line between or through these 2 points. If you have more than 2 points, it's not possible. So we only can do this approximately. This is a minimization problem. So it's an optimization problem. We want to minimize the distance between the points and our function or model function. And this is called a reduced order model, or I can call it a reduced order model because we only have two parameters here, A and B. It's a very simple model. And whereas the data might be, there might be 1 million of these points. And of course, we could also try to build or to derive a much more complicated model. And this is the reason why this is also called a reduced order model. And the other term is regression line, linear regression. So this is a very simple example where we have two parameters that we want to find, and we have some optimization or minimization problem, which is up to now, it's not exactly formalized in mathematical way. We come to this later on. Another example is the training of a neural network. I already mentioned this sometimes, and I think that most of you know the basic structure of a neural network, and this is just one element of the network. So this is what's happening in one node of the neural network. There's an input values, and there's an output value. In this simple example, just one output. And there's always a linear combination of these inputs using some weights and something which is called a bias in a transfer function, which is just a linear combination of the inputs and the weights plus the bias. And then comes an activation function, which in many cases is nonlinear, and then gives the output. And the training of a neural network is that we have inputs and we know what the output is of the problem that we want to simulate using the neural network. So we have given inputs and we have the corresponding outputs. And now we want to train the network such that it can produce exactly this output, or in approximately this output. And this means we want to identify the parameters, the W's here, the B, and maybe some parameters of the activation function. So we want to adjust the weights and the bias to minimize the misfit of the output of the network to some measurement data that we have for the training data set. So maybe here the YK should better be a ZK, which then would correspond to the last slide. This would be the output data for the training, and this is the output of the network. In reality, of course, we have more than one layer. We have a concatenation of several transferred activation functions. So a neural network has several of these neurons or nodes, and it is several layers. So the output of one layer is the input of the next one. So we have a complicated function with lot of weights or lot of parameters that we want to find. And the aim is we have training data with given input where we know the output, and we want to adjust the parameter in such a way that the fit is very good. So for the given inputs and the given outputs, the network can reproduce this mapping quite accurately. And this is also an optimization problem. And here you already find something which is comes closer to the mathematical formulation of the function that we want to minimize. Okay, now I will come to examples for optimization problems, which are a little bit more general. And here you might say that there is not data Of course, there's also data inside, but it's not the classical way that I described on the last slides, where we had data here on all these. Here we had data in the training set. We have data here and data for the output. In this example, I have data. But I will come now to some optimization problems where maybe the data is a little bit in the background. And often, or my example I choose here is an economic problem, which is very simple. And because optimization, maybe you might think of minimization of cost or maximization of profit, which is for many people is the first thing that they think of when they look for optimization. So looking for an economic problem. And this is a very simple example, just to give you an impression how an optimization problem can also look like. And the data here is a little bit in the background. So the example I've taken here from a book is there's a boat rental which a company which wants to buy new boats, and there are two type of boats, a standard one and a premium one, and the gain that they will get, or the revenue that they will get per week is different. So the premium gets more, the profit is higher. Then there are some limits, of course, in such a company. Maybe there can be only a total number of boats, and there might be some demands or some wishes also that there is maximum 200 of these premium boats and more premium than standard. And there's another condition, or which is then called a constraint. The term that I already used, it's a constraint, is there is a time needed per week for the maintaining of these boats, which is different between standard and premium, and there is a constraint on the maximal total working hours per week. So this is an optimization problem, and of course what the idea is to maximize the revenue per week, but there are some constraints. There are two variables here, and the next step, it's not a mathematical formulation, this is a more or less description that might the owner of this company might come to you if you are an optimization expert, and he will tell you this or these facts. You note them, and now your task working in optimization would be to write down a mathematical formulation and to detect what kind of problem it is and how can I solve this. So this is a very simple example, not very difficult to solve. Maybe you could also solve this problem by guessing, but of course there are mathematical ways to solve this problem. A little bit more complicated problem is the following one, which is already simplified. You will see it's already complicated, but still it is simplified to reality. So it's a problem of sustainable fishery, which is a topic, which is a current topic, because many fish stocks are overfished, and for example the European Union have guidelines how many fish are allowed to take out of the ocean such that the fish stocks remain sustainable, so such that in a couple of years there will be fish at all, for example in the Baltic Sea. And let's say we have a temporal distribution of fish in one region of the ocean, which we describe by this variable yi, and the I now refers to a time instant here, and these are discrete time instants. For example, we measure this every week or whatever, or we estimate this. And the idea is to define quotas of the fish stock that is allowed to be fished for in days, months, years, or whatever. And then the aim would be to maximize the profit of a fisherman. And this means we want to maximize, and this is already a more mathematical formulation, we want to maximize the amount of fish in a given interval. So from 1 to n of this time instance, how many the quota of fish that can be taken out, that can be fished. And we want to design this quota. But of course, if you just take this maximum, we would take very high values of q. Q is a vector here of n numbers. This would, of course, maximize this. But then we don't have sustainability inside. Sustainability comes later, but in economic problems, what's typical is that the profit that I get today is worthier than the profit that I get tomorrow, which is usually described by this exponential function with a parameter, the discount rate. It's a positive parameter, it has here a negative sign in the exponential, and you know how an exponential curve looks if you have a negative sign in the exponent. It decays, it goes down very rapidly if the parameter is big. So this indicates that for later times, so if ti is bigger, this factor becomes smaller and smaller, and a profit today or tomorrow has a higher worth for the fishermen than a profit profit then that they made in 1 year. Okay, so this is a description of the gain that the fishermen get out of fishing. But of course there's also an effort of fishing, and one way to model this is that the cost is quadratic in the quota, and so in the part of fish that's taken out with an additional parameter. And you already see here, you don't have to understand all the details because it's just an illustrating example. I just want to show you that realistic problems in optimization can become complicated. And as I said, it's already simplified, or it's still simplified. So if we're taking it into account the cost, then we get a second term here. And usually there we have also a quadratic part here, where you see here, this is just qi appearing, so the quota, and here we have qi squared. So this, up to now, this would be a realistic part for just for an economic problem. We have a gain and we have cost. And we have to put these two in balance somehow and want to minimize the overall gain. But the part in sustainability, sustainable fishing, would be an additional part here inside this optimization problem. So the idea of sustainability would be the total stock should be always bigger than some lower limit. So at the end of the time interval, which is here Tn, there should be some fish remaining. And this can be put inside this formulation that we say, okay, if yn is big, then we give a reward in this function that we want to optimize. We want to maximize this now, so we put a beta with the beta positive here with the end value of the fish. So if at the end is a high amount of fish is there, then the function has a better value, better in the sense that we want to maximize. So now we have already three terms. You see it's complicated, and we can rewrite this also as a minimization problem. So this is a typical, at the beginning I said optimization means maximization or minimization. It's in an economic problem, it makes sense to say I want to maximize my profit, but I can also write it like I want to minimize my cost. So the maximization I can also write as minimization, and I just taking the different signs of these three terms that I have here. So here, minus, here, plus. I can also write this as a minimization. The reason for this is, we will see this later, that many algorithms are dealing with minimization, not with maximization. So this is the first example, the maximization problem. I can also write it as a minimization. But I have lots of parameters. I have the three terms here, which my beta and alpha can weight. I have two weights. So I can say if sustainability is very important, I use a big beta. If the cost it's very important I use a big alpha, and the relation of the this term and the other two terms gives me the weights between these three ideas. I have the three ideas of, yeah, the pure gain here, then the cost, and the sustainability. So I have three parts in my what's called the cost function. We come to the exact terms in a second. So we can weight here profit, sustainability, and cost of fishing. This is a nonlinear problem. Now you see we have an exponential here, but our parameters Q, the quota that we want to find, is also appearing here in quadratic form. In the reality, this is more complex. We have many fishermen, we have a spatial distribution, the fish stock depends, of course, on the fishing. So we have a dynamic problem. So the stock yn, of course, depends on what I take out of the ocean, on the Q. So the yn is not determined beforehand. It's a dynamic problem. And this is becoming much more complicated. But already here you see it's not very easy. The formulation of the problem in mathematics is already complicated. And you also see here that we have different aims or different goals. We have profit, sustainability, and cost that we somehow put together. And you see here already how this can be done, putting all in one function, in one quantity at the end. And one thing that I want to mention with these two last examples is, I said this is not driven by data, or here data is not in the foreground, but of course there is data inside. There are parameters, there is this discount rate, the alpha and beta, they are data. And also in the other example, of course, in this economic problem with the boats, these are all data. The numbers that are appearing here are data. So that's the reason why I mentioned this in the beginning, that an optimization problem always has data inside. There's some parameters which are just given, and it is important to understand what is the parameter that we can optimize or that we want to optimize, and what are fixed parameters. For example, in the fishing example here, I want to find the optimal quotas here, the Q, which was a vector, these Qi here. These are the parameters I can tune, I can choose. On the other hand, I have parameters which are, I assume, as fixed, or they are given by the model, or maybe by the people from application. So the people from application might say, I want sustainability to be very important, the beta has to be big. So don't optimize the beta, optimize the quota. So this is a difference, and this is always appearing in optimization problems. Okay, another problem which is well known is the knapsack problem, which is, yeah, given a number of items which had to be put in some box or knapsack, they need some space or weight, and they have a given value. And we have a knapsack with a given capacity. So which of the items do I put in the knapsack to get the highest value? And here's an example. Usually then you have some tables here. So the task is to maximize the profit or the value of the knapsack. And the parameters are now just choose which of these items to put into the knapsack, and there's again a constraint because the knapsack has a maximum capacity. This is again a constraint. And the other one, which is also well known, is a traveling salesman problem. Find a path, a graph or a path, yeah. Find a path in a graph with a minimal length and or minimal cost. There can be also be some values of cost on this edges here of the graph, and pass every node. So in graphs, usually there are lots of optimization problems. If you want to, if you go by train from Kiel to somewhere, then and you look at the internet or at the app of Deutsche Bahn, you will be looking for maybe the cheapest or maybe the fastest way to honor the graph to come to some other city. These are two very famous examples. I am very brief with these two because they are not completely the topic of our lecture, because they are discrete problems. And now we're coming to the formulation and then the classification of optimization problems. You already saw in this fishery example a function. And I mentioned in the beginning that we always need a quantity that we want to maximize or minimize. And the most general form is to write it as a minimum. So most optimizers write optimization problems as minimization problems. And you saw in the fishery example how you can easily transfer this. You see it also here. Minimum, maximum can be replaced by just taking the negative sign. And the function f, it's what called the cost function or objective function. Usually in our case, we will have a real valued function. And then we have some parameters, the control or optimization parameters. And I always use the notion here, the variable x for them. And yeah, x, there is an admissible set or feasible set where these parameters can come from. And usually this set x, or the x at the admissible set, is a subset of a vector space or an unbounded set. So maybe the set of real numbers. So the quota in the fishing can be real numbers, but maybe they can be all only positive, not negative. The fishermen don't throw fish in the ocean, they take it out. So the quota is always positive what they take out, and then the positive real numbers would be this as admissible set. And the main distinction or one classification is already this unconstrained constraint. If we are looking in the whole vector space, let's say of real numbers or vector real valued vectors here, then we are talking about an unconstrained problem. If it's not the whole space, as example for this fishery where it's only positive numbers are allowed, then we're talking about a constraint problem. And then the admissible set is often defined by functions. And we come to this later. There can be inequality constraints where we have a function where the admissible points or the admissible parameters in the admissible set, they have to be, the value of this function has to be lower or equal zero, or there are can be equality constraints. We come to this and we have to discuss this for every problem, how the admissible set can be formulated in mathematical sense. And constraint and unconstraint is already part of the classification. But there are more. The first category where we look at is the type of the optimization parameters or variables, because they can be also discrete parameters. So buying boats cannot be, I cannot buy 2.5 boats, I can just buy an integer number of boats, or there might be, or if I go in a graph, I can also only take one way or one edge of the graph in the graph, or I don't take it. I cannot half take it. This would be a typical example where the problem is discrete. So it might be a vector of zero and ones, or of natural of integer numbers with sign or without sign. It's called an integer or a discrete problems. And also problems on graphs are of this form. As I mentioned, I can only take one edge or the other, and not half of the train goes over one edge and the other half goes over the other. So this is a discrete problem. The contrast is a continuous problem where we have real valued numbers or real numbers and vectors of real number, because in application problems we usually have high dimensional problems. We have not only one parameter, we have lots of parameters, so the n is very high. And it's also possible that we have a mixture of both. So we have one x1 here, which is discrete, and x2 is continuous, which are mixed integer problems, which are the difficult or most difficult ones. The second distinction is between constrained and unconstrained. I already mentioned this. So can we look in the whole space and have no additional constraints on our parameters, or do we have constraints? Easiest constraint might be the parameters must be positive, or they might or must satisfy some other relation. Another distinction is linearity of the function f and maybe the functions that defining the admissible set. If all these functions are linear, we call this a linear problem, sometimes also a linear program. If either f, g, or h is nonlinear, we call it a nonlinear problem. Special case is a least squares problem, where we can write the cost function as a sum of squares. And this is very often happening when we're dealing with data, because at the beginning, the regression example, finding the regression line through data points or corresponding to data points can be written in such a way. And then we get a linear or nonlinear least squares problem. This would be one part or one class of problems that we treat in a special way. If we have continuous problem, so if we're looking for parameters in Rn, then we will use derivatives, as you did in school, where if you computed the minima of a function, of a real-valued function, you computed the first derivative, set it to zero, and studied these points. So differentiability of the functions involved in the optimization problem is very important and can be very useful. And also many algorithms rely on differentiability. Convexity can also be useful, for example, or especially if we don't have differentiability. So these are the classification. Is it a real valued or continuous problem? Is it constrained or unconstrained? Are the functions linear or nonlinear? And are the functions differentiable? Yeah, and as you know now these, or as you have now these categories, you can go back to the examples that I gave you and try to classify them. And I leave this as a lecture, as an exercise that we might discuss in the next class that we have. Okay. What is important in this lecture, in this first lecture, which is now at the end? Data science is an emerging field in computer science, in science general, and in society. It contains technical as well as algorithmic and as mathematical topics and methods. In this lecture, we study basic methods of data science and the relation of data science to optimization. Many data science problems and methods have a close relation to optimization problems, or in fact, they are optimization problems. And this is also valid for the methods, so not only for the problems, but also for the methods. So many methods in data science use optimization methods. Many optimization problems, or I can say all optimization problems, they have data inside, or they use data, they rely on data. Optimization problems themselves can be formulated in a mathematical way, which is somehow standard. Not in every book, it's always the same, but I gave you one slide where this is the standard that we will use. And the optimization problems can be divided into classes depending on their structure and the type of parameters. And this is the data type of the parameters that are to be optimized. Okay, and this was the first lecture of our course.